alright? Bye. Please don't listen. Okay. Are you listening?
Hello.
Hi guys, and welcome back to the StudyTube Project. We've got a new face on here today. I'm Beth. Hi. Can I just say, it's an absolute honour to be on this channel. I'm on here with some absolute good fangirl. So, hi, I'm Beth. I'm at university. I've just, well, nearly finished second year. And I'm studying a degree in Medical Physiology, which is like a degree stream of biological sciences, and then hopefully after next year I'm going to go on to a graduate course of medicine.
No.
Make sure you go on over to my channel, it'll be linked in the description box, where there'll be some more StudyTube videos sort of coming. There's a lot of Vlogmas on there at the moment, and then a couple other videos, because I'm kind of new to this, but subscribe if you want to see some more. So being as my degree is science, I'm obviously doing a science video, and I've just done a massive module on pharmacology, so I thought that's kind of interesting. It's more interesting than some of the other stuff we do, so I thought I would do a little video on how drugs work. This is mainly going to be focused at a molecular level, not like really complex or anything, like just a brief understanding, like an introduction to pharmacology kind of thing. And we'll see if you enjoy it. If you do, I can do more of these kind of videos, or I can do other stuff, because I was torn with maybe doing like how to play the clarinet or saxophone video. But I doubt many people just have a clarinet lying around if they can't play it already, especially in lockdown. Sorry, I said the L word. I'm not talking about quarantine or corona or lockdown anymore. Hopefully there are going to be some animations on the screen if I can work out how to do that. Well, I can do that, but are they going to be any good? And I don't want to get copyrighted, so I don't want to use any like lecture stuff. Not that they would, but I don't know, I feel like some professors would get a little bit arty if I used their diagrams in this video. Even though their diagrams are so much better than any mine would be, you're going to have to deal with my diagrams. So first off, what is a drug? A drug is any compound which can modify a biological function of a living organism. In other words, it's a ligand that binds to something and causes an effect. Drugs, as you know, can either be recreational, such as marijuana, or it can be for a medical reason such as paracetamol. However, marijuana can also be medical. You get the gist. So drugs can be taken orally, which is, you know, when you swallow a tablet. Sublingually, which means it's something that you put in your mouth and you absorb it through your mouth, so like a little tablet that dissolves and you absorb it. It can be rectal, so through epithelial surfaces, such as like your skin, so if you're putting on eczema cream. They can be inhaled, so, you know, like an inhaler taken for asthma, or they can be injected. So that's the most quick way to get a drug into your system, which is why that's what's given in hospital. Yeah, or if you're doing heroin, that's also injected. So there is a variety of targets that drugs go to in the body, which is how they work. One of the targets is enzymes. So I'm sure you've all done enzymes in GCSE, and drugs either work to inhibit them, so they can bind to the active site of a drug, or in a different place, which changes the shape of it, which will then stop the substrate, which is what's meant to bind to it, from binding. So for example, aspirin, which you take for headaches, binds to cyclooxygenase, which is what stops the headaches from working because that enzyme is then inhibited. Editing Beth here. Can I just say, I've got absolutely no clue why my eyes keep doing that widening thing. I think I'm just trying to get my point across, so I do apologise. You can also get false substrates that bind to enzymes, which the enzyme thinks is what its normal substrate is. So it does all what it has to do to it, then it creates an abnormal product, which is what you don't want. Another target which is really commonly used in drugs is transporters. So these drugs work to inhibit the transporters. For example, omeprazole is a drug which is used to prevent heartburn and acid reflux. So this works by blocking the pump for H+, which is like the acid that causes the heartburn. And similarly, you also get false substrates that work the same way they do in enzymes. And then another massive target is proteins, which I'm going to go into more detail in, but like ion channels. So drugs work by affecting their gating, so the ions can't get through, which I'm sure you also have done in GCSE science. Maybe you haven't. No, you will have. I don't know. But yeah, there's millions of videos on YouTube about this kind of stuff if you want more information, and they probably deliver it a lot better than me, but we're learning. So one of the most common ways drugs work is by binding to a receptor. A receptor is like the first step of cell communication, and it works by basically turning on or off a set of biological responses, so it's like a switch. You get two different kinds of drugs that bind to these receptors. You get agonists, hopefully this is appearing on screen now, which bind and activate the receptor, and then you get antagonists, which bind and prevent activation by an agonist. If you can get your head around that, so you've got the agonists that bind and activate, antagonists that bind and stop. Both are useful and both are how drugs work. It's not that agonists stop drugs working, it's just a different way for them to work. Agonists mimic the endogenous ligand.
What does that mean?
So what would usually bind to that receptor, for example, a sodium molecule or something, an agonist would, if it was to use on the same receptor, would have the same sort of shape as a sodium or act in the same sort of way. Receptors are most commonly found on the membrane of a cell, or they're found within a cell, so once a ligand has gone through the membrane, they're then found on the nucleus, for example. I might have just moved a bit, I had to check I was still recording, because I have got an interesting setup going on, because I left my tripod at university when I was packing to quickly come home, which is also why I'm in my home bedroom of the butterflies. So moving on, there's different classes of receptor, and I thought I would quickly give a brief summary of those. So we have ligand-gated ion channels. This works that a ligand binds, or a drug binds, to the channel, which then changes the shape of it, which we call a conformational change. And that means that the channel has been gated. Therefore, because it's changed shape, there's now a space for what is meant to be going through it to go through. So for example, if it was sodium, once this drug had bound, the channel then changes shape and sodium can come through. Another class of receptor, my favourite class. Can you have a favourite class? Such a nerd. Well, my favourite class of receptor is GPCRs, or G protein coupled receptors. This is a receptor which, funnily enough, is coupled up to a G protein. So the receptor itself has 7 transmembrane regions, which means just the protein structure goes up and down on the membrane like this, and they're all alpha helices, which is just a biological structure. And they are coupled to a G protein. So a G protein is a heterotrimeric protein. That means it is composed of 3 subunits, alpha, beta, and gamma, which you've probably heard of. So when the ligand binds, it binds to the receptor, so one of the 7 transmembrane bits. Well, obviously the bits on the outside of the cell, which then causes a conformational shape change again, remembering the keyword of conformational. This then causes the G protein to dissociate into the alpha subunit, goes off on its own, and the beta and gamma subunit go off together. So they become a subunit of just beta and gamma. That's not really important anymore. Well, it can be, it can stimulate other things, but in this example, that's not important anymore. So however, the alpha unit has been dissociated, so it can move around in the cell, but it's not active yet. So this is where another part comes in. So another thing I didn't mention is on the G protein is a little molecule called GDP. You don't need to know what that stands for, it's just GDP, and that is on the alpha subunit. So then we get Geff come along, or Jeff as I like to call him, G-E-F. So it can also be Jeff, just easier to remember. Which comes along to where the GDP is, and it displaces it for GTP. I know there's a lot of letters and it's a bit confusing, but it's not, once you get your head around it, it's not that complicated. And it exchanges it, so then the alpha subunit becomes active, and now because it's active, it's able to move around the cell and go to the target protein. These G proteins are quite diverse and you get a lot of different types of them. For an example, if the receptor was a B adrenoreceptor, which means that what binds to it naturally is adrenaline and other molecules will mimic adrenaline, that's coupled to a G alpha S protein. Or if you have an A2 adrenoreceptor, so it's just another type, again it's adrenaline, that is coupled to a G alpha I protein. Both of these work on the same target molecule but have opposite effects. The G alpha S route activates a protein called adenyl cyclase, and G alpha I inhibits that protein, so they're working against each other. So let's go with the activating route. So our ligand, a drug, has bound to the B2 adrenoreceptor. I'll give you an example of what does that. Salbutamol, which you may not know what it actually is, but it's in what's inside blue inhalers, so it's what you use for asthma. So start guessing now what you think the end product of this is going to be. So the salbutamol binds to the B2 adrenoreceptor, causes a shape change, the alpha subunit comes off, the Jeff changes the GDP to the GTP, and the alpha runs over here to the adenyl cyclase. Now, what adenyl cyclase does is it converts ATP, which you've probably heard of, it's what's made through respiration, to cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP is a second messenger. This means it carries on this little route, but it's no longer the main drug, but the drug has still made this work. So the cyclic AMP then goes to a protein kinase, in particular protein kinase A. Kinases are proteins which are responsible for phosphorylating, and they have loads of effects throughout the body. So protein kinase A, in this case, phosphorylates a protein called MLCK, and this actually inhibits it, which then allows for the answer for what the final product, broncho or vasodilation. This is obviously useful if you're asthmatic and your airways are constricted, as this allows them to dilate and more blood and therefore oxygen can get through.
I think that's quite interesting how that works. You might not, if you don't, feel free to leave.
So moving on from the GPCRs, I've talked about them enough. You can probably tell my heart goes out to the GPCRs. I'm so cringy. So another type of receptor is an RTK or a receptor tyrosine kinase. Kinase words comes up again, it's a phosphorylated one. I'm not going to really discuss this too much, but basically a ligand bind which causes clustering, so two different kinases clustered together, and they are then dimerized, which means they work as a pair and are then able to do their job. And then, as I briefly mentioned earlier, not all receptors are on the cell membrane. We also have ones intracellularly. Funnily enough, these are called intracellular receptors, or otherwise known as nuclear receptors. So these act as gene activators or suppressors. All of the gene stuff and the DNA stuff goes on inside the nucleus. So obviously something binding to the nucleus is going to suppress or activate the gene factory, if you will. But obviously because it's intracellular, the ligand has got to have been able to pass through the first membrane of a cell into the cytoplasm and then to the nucleus, which means the ligand has to be able to passively diffuse and has therefore got to be hydrophobic, which just means it can get through the hydrophobic membrane. So that's kind of like a brief summary of all of that, but I thought I'd give you quickly a few specific drugs, because I just think it's so interesting to know what we're actually putting into our body and how it works. Drugs obviously can be taken for mental health and depression. So if you've been to the doctor for any sort of mental health problem, they might have said, oh, I'll give you this, it's an SSRI. And you've gone,
what's an SSRI?
That means it's a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. So this actually works in neurons, which is obviously what's all in the brain and goes throughout all our body. But they specifically work at the junction between two neurons, and they, as it says, reuptake serotonin. So it means more of the serotonin goes back into your system, which is what hopefully makes you feel happier. So you may have heard of thrombosis, which is when plaques which build up in blood vessels, which can lead to things like heart failure or strokes, which obviously aren't very nice. So drugs can work by inhibiting platelets, so that's what makes you clot, so that doesn't happen. A way to stop heart failure would be to use a calcium channel blocker. So again, it works in the neurons by blocking calcium, which is the type of neurotransmitter. And an example of this is verapamil. And then finally, I just thought I'd talk quickly about a more recreational one, which is amphetamines, which you have probably heard of, but they regulate synapse activity again. So that's that bit between two neurons. And they work by blocking the reuptake of transmitter, enhancing the release of the neurotransmitter, and inhibiting the breakdown, which altogether means there's loads of that neurotransmitter in the synapse, which is what gives you the feeling of a high, for example. I hope you found this video interesting. If you have, make sure you give it a big thumbs up and please come over to my channel. I am new, just a little YouTuber, and I'd love to see you all over there. If you want more videos explaining more sciencey stuff about the human body, I would love to get involved. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you're safe. I hope all your family is healthy and well. I hope you haven't been too bored. If you have, I'm sure there'll be a video about something completely different tomorrow.
And that's the beauty of the StudyTube Project.
So thank you so much for watching. I'm Beth, and I'll see you real soon. Bye!